I think that's good. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the first MBA Lite program of the Burton D. Morgan Entrepreneurship Series. We have a really exciting speaker from Akron University with us tonight. Come on in if you're just coming in. There's handouts in the back. Tonight we have with us Professor Jaewon Choi from Akron University, as I said. Prior to joining the University of Akron in 2011, he spent 1 year for his postdoctoral research at the 3D Innovation Center at the University of Texas at El Paso. After his involvement with the WM Keck Center, he was promoted twice, first to the rank of research specialist in 2008, and then to research assistant professor in 2009. Currently, he's serving as an editorial board member in several journals of additive manufacturing, which is essentially 3D printing, the Korean Society of Manufacturing Processing Engineers, and the Korean Society of Mechanical Technology. Currently, he is intensively working on 3D printed tactile sensors for robotics, prosthetics, consumer products, and other things like that. We also have a few upcoming events that I forgot to mention. Our distinguished speaker of the series is Jack Plunkett. That's going to be Thursday, October 29th at 6:30 p.m. And our next MBA Lite program, if you're interested in coming to that, is Strategic Analysis and Planning on Wednesday, November 4th at 6:30 p.m. So let's give a welcome to Dr. Choi.
Thank you. I'm honored. When I got the invitation from Jamie, thought this might not be to me because professor, this is kind of, you know, things related to entrepreneurial things. So to be honest, a little bit, you know, hesitated at that time, but I heard, you know, 70 people here, so it's amazing. I think this 3D printing, the technology of the industry is growing. So also many of you recognize, you know, this technology. So I'm very happy to give a talk tonight. So I wanted to share what I'm doing with some state of art of 3D printing. Actually, I'm teaching 3D printing and additive manufacturing. Those are the same, but I'll tell you why we use the terminology 3D printing, also additive manufacturing. I'm teaching that course, or I'm teaching computer-aided manufacturing design, because I developed a lot of lab courses related to manufacturing, especially 3D printing. So some of my tutors are from this semester I'm teaching in 3D printing. So some materials are from the existing materials, some of the materials are, I obtained some of them from, I think, YouTube or some website. You know, it's fast changing technology, so I can't, you know, use my textbook, okay? So the internet stuff is much better than what I have. So some of them, you know, you can find, you know, some materials in the website. Okay, so really boring here. I tried to find some good first slide, okay, to get your attention better, but I couldn't find. There is some movie like Spy. They use the 3D printing technology to advertise their movie. I've never seen that, but I searched that, but I didn't understand what they were doing, so I couldn't put that here. But here, okay, the rapid prototyping was the first terminology before the advent of the word 3D printing or additive manufacturing. So as you see, you know, we used this technology for prototyping a long time ago, 20 years ago. But the prototype, as you know, process for rapidly creating a system or part before final production. So there are a lot of iterations in design and manufacturing production. So it used to be many iterations in design, manufacturing, GE fixture, a lot of things. So once they use this technology, they can reduce the cost for production. They can make, we can make the part quickly. But the later people try to use this technology for something else, that is actual production. Okay? Nowadays, you know, we don't use rapid prototyping, but some people may use rapid prototyping, RP, okay? It's known, but we don't use RP anymore because this technology is being used for even production. I'll show you some example later on. Okay, I don't want to go over all the text, just let's keep. And 2007, ASTM, the technical committee, think the F42 committee, they adopted additive manufacturing as a new technology instead of rapid prototyping because it's not anymore for prototyping. This actual manufacturing, and the process is additively manufactured. So they take they took this technology, and then. Like me, you know, the researchers started to use this technology when you wrote a paper, whatever. But the 3D printing, my understanding is from 2012, I guess the president initiated some manufacturing innovation regional hub stuff. Then he used 3D printing because this is better, you know, word for instead of, you know, additive manufacturing. Then my understanding is that from that time, a lot of guys, even, you know, my kids, elementary, you know, school students, they got to know, you know, this one. So now we, you know, we use both technologies together. But 3D printing is not, was not a representative technology. It was just one process. Okay, I'll show you that later. Okay, working principle is here. We, I don't know, may I ask you, your background is not engineering, right? Maybe some of you? Okay, but some of you are not. So anyway, we can create a model, 3D model, okay, using computer software, a lot of different software. Okay, in the background, we use Creo, ProEngineer, Katia, a lot of nice software. There's computer-aided design and manufacturing software. So we design that, and then we can machine that, okay, based on the model. Here, once we have a model like this, okay, this computer model, then we can slice it. Virtually, I mean, in a computer software. Then each slice is manufactured in a machine that is in a 3D printing machine. Then we can have the final product. So as you see here, if you have a thin layer, you can think about this paper, okay? When you buy a paper pack, one pack, it has a volume, right? If you take just one paper, very thin, you may not think about the volume for that. But when you cut it, okay, place it, you can use a glue, okay? And then you can cut next, you know, paper, and then glue, attach it. And then what if you use, you know, 1,000 paper? Then you can create the volume, right? Same thing, this is additive manufacturing, very simple. So if you use very thin paper, you can have very precise, you know, structure, right? But if you, you can use, you know, thick one, okay, thick paper, okay, cardboard, whatever, then, you can have, you need just, you know, maybe 50 slices, okay, instead of 1,000 slices with thin, you know, paper. But you will lose some precision, you know, resolution. Okay? But you can make it faster. So there are many different processes. Some people, I never counted, but some people said more than 60 different processes. Okay, but there are several representative processes which are in a good shape in terms of their business and also technology. Okay, I don't know what this is. Okay, first, again, you know, the entire, you know, the operation, even though there are different processes, you know, this process is almost similar. So once we have a solid model, 3D model in the computer, and then we need to convert that to specific format, which is STL format. STL is stereo lithography. Then we need to put that in a specific file to machine software. Then machine can handle that file, and then machine can make a tool path, and finally machine operate. So this is a series of operation. Some milestone in AM development, you know, I don't know when you got to know this 3D printing. I heard this almost 20 years ago. Even when I heard this first time in 1990s, it was not new at that time. Okay, somebody already worked on that technology. So it started from in 1984, patent in Japan, known as the US. And this is one of the earlier commercialized 3D printer. So patented by Charles Hill. He's still, I think, executive CEO of 3D Systems. And he had this patent. His patent is expired, but he commercialized first 3D printers with the name of a stereoisographic process we call SLA. The process we call SL, that's a stereoisography. Then, in 1986, many other companies, so Helisys, Cubiter, DTM, these guys established company DTM, and their process is selective laser sintering. They use a powder material, they use a laser, they could create a structure. So those, I think this is Joseph Beeman, professor in UT Austin. Still, there are three very famous professors at UT Austin who developed this process. Okay, it's pretty much, you know, old technology, right? It's almost 30 years. Then 1989, and then fused deposition modeling, patented by Scott Trump. He formed the company Stratasys. Now Stratasys shares the biggest market, and then 3D Systems, the Charger, I guess, maybe second, I'm not sure. Anyway, these two are kind of a dinosaur in this area. This is the old FDM system. Then, in the same year, MIT developed 3D printing process, and they licensed the technology to G-Corp and some other companies. And this is also the G-Corp machine. I'll show you some fabricated structures and process in more detail in the next several slides. Then 1994, this inkjet technology, think about this, simply your inkjet printer, okay? Paper printing, the same thing. They use the technology to build the 3D structure. In 2001, and then they use, okay, here they use ink as a binder, here they used ink as a model material, actual material, I'll show you that. Okay. Several representative 3D printing processes. First one is a VAT photopolymerization. Okay, it's solidified a thin layer, okay? You can think about this paint or some, we call it resin, okay? It's a liquid material. Also, we can use composite. So this is schematic of the process, the laser hatches the resin, and they can create very complicated structures. Let me show you YouTube. I like, you know, YouTube. Even the same thing, I used to use these, you know, materials for my students. It's short, just 2 minutes. I'll just, you know, skip the some Okay, these are laser, okay? It's a laser, okay? It's an UV ultraviolet laser, and then here it's a transparent photopolymer. Once the material gets that attacked by the laser, then it's cured.
It's used to create parts from 3D CAD data in a matter of hours. SL technology typically uses layers, typically about 6,000 layers thick. This data is then transferred to an SLA additive manufacturing system containing a vat of UV curable photopolymer. The machine begins to build the part one layer at a time.
I think this is the extra speed.
It's constructed from an ultraviolet laser that is directed by X and Y scanning mirrors.
Controlled X, Y, coordinate.
As the laser traces the cross-section on the surface of the resin, the liquid material is hardened on contact. Once a layer is complete, the build platform is indexed down to make room for the next layer. A refoder blade moves across the surface, ensuring a thin coat of fresh liquid resin is evenly spread.
Once one layer is built, cured by laser, then this platform goes down, so that the surrounding liquid material can cover the existing previous built layer.
Thread over the object. The laser continues to trace and form each layer atop the previous layer, building from the bottom up.
Here, some structures, right? Those are not mother structures. These are called support. If you don't have these structures, this part will be collapsed. That's why we need the support here. That those will be removed.
The completed part
this actual
is
part
carefully removed from the liquid and separated from the platform.
And here's a support.
Removes excess resin.
Some post-processing.
And part is cured in an ultraviolet oven. Any support structures are removed.
It's a post-curing process.
With numerous hand-sanding and professional paint options available through service providers such as Solid Concepts, stereolithography has become an excellent economic choice for rapid appearance models. A wide variety of industries have embraced SLA, including medical, automotive, entertainment, aerospace, and consumer products.
Okay, that's enough. So I'm not a CS guy, but I brought out a part here, okay? I used to show this part to my student, so I just wanted to introduce some examples. I thought I brought some nice structure like Chesapeake Brook, but I forgot to bring. So this, I use this as a mold for making some spherical shape. So anyway, this was manufactured by this process. I will just turn around. Okay, and then next, see here, we can be very in a complicated process because we don't need to have tool access, okay? There's no tool collision. Think about some cutting process, drilling. If there is some existing material, you cannot reach the bottom the surface, right? But this process, there's no interference. Okay? You can build structure from the bottom to the top. As I told you, simply you can put the one paper, the next paper, there's no interference between tool and then material or material. And then next one is the powder bed fusion. Instead of a photopolymer, wicked photopolymer here, we use powder. You can use some food material too. Okay? Then we use laser, or we can use some glue, eatable glue, that's also possible. But in this is industrial printer, okay? But we are supposed to use in the food material. But here, there's a powder, then a laser melt or sinter powder. So also you can produce some precise structure, turbine structure, also a lot of metal-based structures. I'll show you this video. Then extrusion-based process, the thrust assist had a patent, but it's expired. So currently, my understanding is more than 90% of low-cost machines. I think Hudson Library has one, right?
Yeah, we have a MakerBot.
Yeah, MakerBot, those are low-cost machines. There's no definition for low-cost machine, but I can say maybe less than $5,000. Okay. So patent expired, that's why, you know, a lot of guys, companies, startup companies, to develop this, use that technology to develop their own machines. So this something like, you know, cake icing, okay, or you can just squeeze toothpaste, right? And then you can control the location, something like that. Let's see. Another YouTube video.
DM is a layer that accurately produces feature details and has 3D CAD data into layer.
It uses a solid filament.
Thin thread-like spools of thermoplastic and support material are used to create each cross-section of the part. Similar to a hot melt glue gun, uncoiled material is slowly extruded through
nozzles.
The extrusion nozzles precisely lay down both support and thermoplastic material upon the preceding layers. The extrusion nozzle continues to move in a horizontal XY plane while the build platform moves down, building the part layer by layer. Finished part is removed from the build platform and cleaned of its
There's a support, the white material is support.
Raw FDM parts have visible layer lines. However, service providers such as Solid Concepts offer multiple finishing options to create smooth, even
and some post-processing to make the surface better, surface finishing.
Since FDM parts are constructed with production-grade thermoplastics.
Okay, that's enough.
Thank you. I've never seen the actual machine. So it's carbon fiber, so highly, the rainforest here, the same process.
Printing process, you can think about just paper printer. We need a little bit of expedite, you know. Oh, I forgot what example. This is from the SLS, okay, powder and the laser, okay, no assembly, but it, you know, it's, you can fold them forward, whatever, okay.
There is some powder.
PolyJet is a layer additive manufacturing technology, quickly and economically. Deal for smaller parts, appearance, an inch, constructing the object one layer at a time.
There's ink cartridge, and this is an inkjet head. Print material,
simple.
But different from the different thing from, you know,
similar how an inkjet printer layer.
Paper printing is, it has a volume, it prints a volume.
Ultraviolet curable material on the build platform, eventually forming a single cross section of the part.
It's not that fast, okay? Thank you. 10 times
faster. Simultaneously curing material as it changes. Once a cross section is complete, the build platform is lowered slightly, making it to the next layer. As the part is built, support material is added to give supplemental strength to fine structures and down facing surfaces. After all of the layers have been created,
support material is pretty weak, so you can easily, you know, break it. So this structure is built.
Although finishing is not necessary, the number of hand sanding and paint options are available. Service providers such as Solid Concepts. PolyJet parts are well suited for quick, economical prototypes, requiring exceptional detail, surface finish, and edge visualization. PolyJet is ideal for a wide range of industries, including medical, entertainment, consumer products, automotive, and industrial design.
So you can imagine, you know, different colors, right? You can use I don't know, RGB or cyan, magenta, different colors, and then you can make a true color, right? But same thing, we can use different material. We can mix the material in process. So here is one material is used, but not assembly process. It's kind of two, okay, it moves. But this one, I think at least 7 different material were used in a single printer. The paper thing, okay? It's simple. I'm gonna skip, you know, the video because I will spend 30 minutes. This one, okay, it was made by just paper. You can print it, then glue, okay, paper, cut, and then bond. Deposition process. I'd better show you the video. We can deliver material through a nozzle. Okay? You can blow a material, powder. Okay? It's not real time, it's faster. Then focused laser can melt, okay, the material, the powder material, in specific location. They build in a 3D structure. They told the 3D printing, it was just one process. Okay. MIT used this 3D printing as a technology for showing their process with 3DP. And then additive manufacturing, AM, was defined by ASTM. But now in the 3D printing additive manufacturing, I use simultaneously. I did search in 2014, 3D printing, this additive manufacturing almost 6 times. Right? That means it was more popular. Okay. Actually, to be honest, I didn't like the 3D printing. I didn't like to use 3D printing as a researcher, but later on, I just adopted this terminology. Even in my paper, sometimes I use 3D printing. Okay, because reviewers can easily understand what that is. If I use 3D additive manufacturing, they may not understand. So even my proposal, I used to use 3D printing. Okay, so let's see. There are common questions that I have gotten so far. You may have other questions, but I can take that question later on. But what can you do with 3D printing more? What happened for the last 3 decades? Because I told you, it was developed in 1980s, right? Still a challenge. And how about the conventional manufacturing technologies, the lathe mill, injection molding? How about future? So I just tried to get some answers for those questions for myself. So here I got this chart from Wallace Report. This is annual report for 3D printing industry and also technology. In 2014, they reported like this, it's not just prototyping, also, okay, see here, applications. So fit and assembly and two functional port. There should be some prototyping. Patterns for casting, visual aids. So it's not just prototyping anymore. There's also a lot of different industries, in the aerospace, consumer product. Okay. So for example here, Boeing applied this patent. Okay. They applied patent with 3D printed part in their airplane. So you may not recognize, I didn't recognize by last night. I knew they built a kind of a landing gear part, but I just got to know this patent. Then some report says they are using more than 20,000 parts. Okay, it's not flying. That is not prototype, right? That's actual part. This is one example. This is a hinge for jet engine. The good thing is this is conventional. This is a new one. Good thing is we can realize whatever design you have. If you imagine, we can build. That is a good thing. Because there's high flexibility to make the part. I mean, we think about if you use this one and this one, we can save material, light material. Okay, mechanically, we can make it stronger. Okay? We can do some analysis better. So what we used to say is, if you imagine, we can build it using 3D printing. The last 3 decades, actually, I don't have 2014 version because it's too expensive. It's $400, for the annual report. So I stopped buying in 2014. Okay, so going here, 13, it's almost 10,000. I think this is accumulated number of the printers. The 10,000 machines were sold out. Excluding low-cost machines, just industrial machines. And this is revenues in millions of dollars. It's pretty 3,000 million. Right? The bottom, this product, I mean the materials, systems, things, and this is services, okay, to make part for somebody else. So it's growing. See here, 2012, okay. It's like this, and then just exploded. So I'll show you why. Still challenge. This is a hype curve for the new technology. You may not recognize all the, you know, the letters here, but 3D, okay. So once, you know, new technology comes in, we become interested, right? And then later we get to know, oh, this is nothing, or this is something. So 2011, it was here, like, 3D printing got some interest, okay? Then 12 was top. The bubble should be broken at that time. Then still, 2014 is here, it's getting down. For example, some smartphone technology is here. It was here, okay? It was fancy, right? Then all bubbles were broken, then comes to this area, and then the steady sellers forever. So I hope 3D printing can come to this area so that, you know, the technology can stay. But still, there are a lot of things with bubbles, okay? People think, so we can build whatever, what I said, you know, we can build whatever we imagine, but behind the process and technology, there are a lot of things to be considered, even post-processing. You can build a part, like this kind of part, within a day, but sometimes, you know, post-processing takes time, okay, more than a day. You saw, you know, the metal part, right? But to finish the part, it takes, you know, a long time. Then conventional manufacturing technology. I have been attacked by my colleagues many times because I have been working on the 3D printing more than 15, 16, 17 years. Also, I have many friends who are working on conventional manufacturing, you know, injection molding, mill, you know, those cutting processes. But what I'm thinking is we can come together. Okay, I don't think 3D printing can be a substitute for conventional manufacturing. This is my personal thought. Here, okay, traditional manufacturing, we have in a more unit, okay? Think about, you know, cell phone cover, okay? We need to use injection mold, right? This is the best. We cannot replace that. But if you think about just small number, many different designs, you can't have mold, right? It's too expensive. Then, here, okay, it's competitive. But the same design, the quantity is in a million, then we can't compete. So this is some graph to show you know, 3D printing versus, you know, traditional manufacturing. So there is a process like additive and then machining. Once you have some part with beam deposition process, we also need to cut out to make better surface. Okay? But the reason why I put this, you know, photo here is 3D printing is not alone. It has to work with existing technologies. So we, you know, work together. Future, hard to tell, you know, future, but I guess better 3D printing is promising. 10 years ago, materials, laser, those technologies were not mature, but now it's more mature. So we have a nice machines, but it's too expensive. Some machine is more than $1 million. But promising, I guess the price gets down. Bioprinting, I guess it's promising. Maybe this is a science fiction at this time, to be honest, but may happen. I'm also working on 3D printing of biomaterials. Also, I like to print, you know, just mechanical structures, okay, just some pieces, turbine, whatever. But I'm also very interested in printing sensors, actuators, electronics, smart structures. Actually, this is my research area. This is ENIAC, the first computer, kind of first computer, right? This is ARPANET, like the communication, packet communication, developed in 1968 in DARPA, I guess. At that time, I think those who developed or suggest this, okay? The technologies and this packet communication didn't expect this stuff. Facebook, Google, Twitter, this is a pretty old one, but we, you know, to 15 years, I don't know what we have here. Anyway, they didn't expect this one. So if a student asked me what I used to tell is like internet, okay? My role is to have students exposed to this technology, and then they can use this technology for something else. I have no idea about them, what they will do. My kids, or next generation, can utilize this technology for something else, like computer or, you know, internet. I hope. Okay, and then big leap in the United States. 2012, as I briefly introduced, National Additive Manufacturing Institute was established in Youngstown. I was also involved in proposal writing things. Then more than $70 million were invested so far for project. But the thing, the different thing is, from just a research project is, here, university usually, you know, we develop some technology, whatever here. The industry needs some mature technology here. There, this is a death of value. So they want to fill out to get this, you know, value. So we have to, in the proposal team, we have to bring at least one company, also the technology readiness level, and there's a mature level, has to be 4 to 6. That means right after the university lab and before, you know, production things. So they fund those kind of research, not, you know, fundamental research. But this is America Makes homepage. America Makes, they change the name, America Makes. Yeah, their motto is America Makes, America Works. Yeah. Makes sense. Okay, some advances in 3D printing. Just some examples, not all. I used to work on 3D micro printing. So this is dime, and then individual chess pieces, you know, were printed using micro printing. This scale bar is 1 millimeter, that is, I'm not familiar with inches. Okay, 10 times over your hair diameter is 1 millimeter. So it's tiny. I used a photopolymer-based projection process to make those pieces. Definitely I cannot play, but this is for demonstration of the capability. Some other features, some scale bar is 500 micron. So 5 times your hair diameter here to here. And 30 micron is 1/3 of your hair diameter. Okay, this size is pretty small, right? See, those are not functional structures, but currently I'm trying to use these technologies for drug delivery devices, some other applications. And then 3D, okay, this was 3D micro printing, and then this is 3D nano printing. I've never worked on this one. I think this is kind of art for me. Like this, this is hair. Then, so, right? Spider is very tiny. Just the feature size is 1/100th of your hair diameter. The base tiny. You know, you can compare simply in a red blood cell is 7 micron. Okay, this one. So this is 15 micron here to here. So I guess that this head, you know, spider head, the same as this one. And some, I think this is a light guide. It's a nanometer size. This is 2 micron, so this whole, you know, this is also a nanometer size. Very tiny. More examples, the influenza virus is 20 nanometer. This is a 96 nanometer pattern. It's a 2D pattern. So, some more examples. The things. Okay, awesome, right? But it, almost 10 years ago, okay, they did it. They finished. The thing is, we need some actual application. Those are very important. I'm looking for on the applications, or so people are looking for applications. And so I want to refer to 4D printing or 3D printing beyond 3D printing. Okay. MIT guy used this name first. It's a fancy, it's good. But some people worked, I think before, you know, they used this name, like, you know, shape memory polymer. They use that for 4D printing. This is the, once you print the part, then there's one more degree, like one more change in color or shape, okay, volume, whatever. Then we call that 4D printing. Again, YouTube. They use two different materials, black and some other material which absorbs water, and then volume changes. And they just, you know, joint, okay. No change in this frame, no. So they can program this. As long as we know the environment, we can print, and then we can use some material which can react with the environment, and we can program the structure. Next one is building a base on the moon or Mars. NASA or so, something like NASA in Europe, they already started the project. So there is a 3D printing in space, they started. See this one. We need some construction, right? We need the house, we need a thing for Luna later on. Then this is kind of rubber cleaner. So they can use, you know, lunar soil, right, to print structure. So some researchers, the concept is simple, but there should be great progress, you know, to realize this concept. Some researchers started to use some moon soil. He cannot get that, but he can mimic, you know, those, you know, compositions. So he did some experiment, okay, using laser to melt, you know, lunar soil to make a structure. Then we can use this technology to build a house. Three opinion, Catherine.
Yeah, you heard the saying that a man
combined three walls
of okay, or layer, or layer.
Pieces of the turrets were.
Let's see.
Thanks, Bill.
And this we call the cladding machine. It's concrete. A simple one. Same, you know, concept. One Chinese company in China establish a startup company to build a house. Okay, they can build a house. I don't know how big, maybe 100 square foot like that. They can build a house within 24 hours. Some manual job. I don't know why they didn't print the top portion. They can. Alright, maybe. But they can put some wood and then they can. Okay. This is my research. 3D print your skin sensors. We developed some materials and also some processes. There's no reliable process to print my materials. That's why we developed a process. I'm not a material scientist, material engineer, but I'm a manufacturing guy. But I used to, you know, develop my own material or so process. So those black things, think about it, you know, the nerves. And we can make it flexible. And we can put some PCB there, some different geometries. Here's some testing with those. You can think about some nerves, okay? And press it, and then we get signals, okay? Then you have over more than 200 mechanoreceptor in 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter, okay, this size. So as long as we have those grid there, we can, you know, mimic the human skin. So, okay, more example. I put those sensors in the robotic gripper, and then some object, right, detecting the force. Once we know the force, and then we can control the gripping force. And then we use the molding technology to make this in a real finger-like structure. Then sensors embedded inside, right, detect some signals. No, not signals, detect forces, and then it transmits signals. This is more like, you know, robotic arm. Then we use 3D printing process to make a fingertip, and then a sensor is embedded, and then you just press, you know, the tip here, then it detects, you know, those pressures. So now we try to use this technology, these sensors, for prosthetic hands, so robotic skins, so some smart inserts that I will introduce later on, also pressure measurement device. So far just the introduction of 3D printing, but my understanding is a lot of you are interested in entrepreneurial stuff. Recently I established a company, startup company, what's the name right here? Smart 3D Solutions. Then we have a business model, you know, smart insole. So I just wanted to tell you the history, you know, how we established the company based on the technology that we have. So we got the support from NSF, National Science Foundation. They called iCore team. And they support technology commercialization. What we have to do is to get out of building. Okay, this is key. We have to have interviews, in-person or phone interview, but we did more than 200 in-person interviews to find out customer pains. We tested our value propositions. And then we find out the minimal viable product, which will be bought by some specific group. Once I have the revenue, then I can think about next item. So we have to have a minimum viable product. Then in the last month, this month, we established a company, this one. A team here, he was my student, but he got a PhD in August. He was an entrepreneur lead, but recently he got a job in San Jose, and he will leave next month. Okay. Me and then mentor, Tom, I think he lives in Boston. Okay. So our initial value proposition was sense of touch for prosthetic hands. We thought we could provide sense of touch for prosthetic amputees. That's our kind of, you know, a hypothesis, okay, which to be tested. These are technologies, and we met people. Not the guys that we met, but did some photos. But anyway, they need some sense of touch. Okay, we knew that, and then we did think almost 30 to 40 interviews with amputee. It was not easy, but we did it. Our hypothesis here, externally powered hands are the preferred operating prosthetic. But the thing is, they don't like to use externally powered hands. They want to use, not all of them, okay, but many people want to use just body powered, you know, prosthetic. Okay, just, you know, based on their, you know, motion, they can control, you know, like this, you know, grip. That is, you know, more reliable. They like to use that. Also, we have only partial product. That is, we have a sensor. How can you deliver sensing signal to the brain? That's very important, right? But we can't do that. I'm not those, you know, scientists. So we need to wait until they develop the technology. So ours is just partial solution. Terms of in the business. And also, our target market is very small. We thought it's 140 million. But later on, we got to know it's 4 million. It's too small. Okay. I mean, this is market size. Conclusion, we needed to pivot. Then we did it. It was pain. Okay. So we searched some other applications with the technology. So Walmart, Target, their warehouse, they might need some, you know, sense of touch for robots, okay? Because they have so many different products, some pressure, power, different, right? So they need sense of touch. We thought that. Also, Home Depot, right? And or farm robot, you know, the harvesting, you know, fruit. But we got some feedback, or this was a partial problem solution. They need many other things to be considered, not just, you know, sense of touch. What if, you know, in the farm, you know, robot should reach some areas bumpy, right? That has to be solved. It's not easy. Okay, ours is a partial solution. Then we thought about the smart insole. This is kind of gait analysis, gait testing, you know, system. And we thought, okay, what we found is gait lab, they can, you know, researchers or people can get data just the lab, not outside the lab. So if we can provide some gait analysis, you know, gait is very important, right? Then there should be something. That is our assumption. Then we tested this hypothesis with runners. Initially, we got, I think, just 30 to 50 runners. We met individually. Our target runners is you know, weekly, you know, 30 miles. They run, and the race time is more than half marathon because they have more interest in the gait when they run. And then they used to use a running monitoring system. Also, overstride is very important. I don't know if you recognize it or not, but overstride, if you have overstride, you will lose your power, energy, and then speed gets down. Also, you will get injured. So we found some based on 37 interviews, but recently we got more than 100 interviews from Akron Marathon. So this market size is pretty big. And so we assume the 10 million runners spending $50 to $100 for their product, then it's a 1 billion market. That is just a target market, but also served in the total market is 52 million runners in US. It's a lot. And then this pattern diagram is competitive competitors, also some collaborators. Those, you know, shoe manufacturers or some Garmin, like a monitoring device manufacturers. We may need to work together or we need to compete that. So this is our environment. Okay, so we're still working on this one to commercialize our technology. To go ahead, we need more funds. You know, we have technology, but we have to have reliable technology. That means, you know, repetitive, okay? You know, reproducible. So we are applying for more funds, like, you know, some commercialization funds. Okay, so far this is my technology transition story. Okay. I tried to get some information for business cases. So one of my students in my class, actually he has his own low-cost 3D printers. He's very interested in business in 3D printing, using low-cost printing. So I got this slide from him. So according to him, you know, a lot of individual owners of 3D printers exist, okay, even in Akron. They can share the machine. So here, from this website, 23,000 printers. Also local Akron, he mentioned, but I'm not sure exactly, you know, this, so how he got this one. But this is his, you know, class project. He's supposed to submit project by the end of November. I may be able to share that result with you later, but now I don't have it. But anyway, there's some businesses in local springs. And Robert Designs, located in Akron, Aaron, he's here. Some parts were produced from his company. Okay, he does some businesses in the design and manufacturing. Okay, I think if you have questions, I think I can grab him here and then he can answer your questions. There's a technology house located in Solon. My understanding is they are also doing some businesses. They have a metal machine, they have supporting machines. They do service. And then Boundary Systems is a strong sphere. They are distributor of Stratasys. They do service. I think Aaron, you may know this better, right? So in the Akron area, Akron, you know, Cleveland, there are several businesses, okay, but not a lot, which is different from what I thought, because I thought this, you know, even Cleveland, Akron is manufacturing basis, right? But we don't have, you know, enough facilities here. So I think there's some opportunities. Okay, this is done. So if you have any questions, for the technology or business cases, I'll try to answer. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, the problem, kind of problem is 3D printing is good for low volume and many different designs, right? So maybe customized thing is good, but thing is, this is consumer product, like smart insert consumer product. So if we can, you know, make it customized, but the cost gotta be higher. So what we think is, we use 3D printing technology to develop the, you know, sensors or smart shoes. But eventually, we need to scale up, you know, the mass production. We may need to use some mass production, some other, you know, nice, just existing conventional process. But also, on the other side, once we earn some money with that, you know, minimum viable product, what we will do is we will, you know, create more models, like customized shoes. Or so what if, you know, you got some surgery and then, you know, when you go to the hospital, you can get in a gait analysis, right? How about what if, you know, at home? Then you can have, you know, shoe, and then we can send transmit signal to the hospital, and the doctor can monitor, right? The environment is different. Gait analysis in the lab is different, you know, than in, at home. So some customized stuff, that's also my interest. Yeah, Aaron, you can, you know. Let me introduce him. You know, he does a business on the, this one. this public design company. So that's his part.
Yeah, so that part there is absolutely developed at the same time. So you take your assemblies, and the technology's come up such a far, you know, it's come so far right now, you can take and you can create those assemblies all at one time. So again, using the CAD systems that you have available to you, whatever it is, doesn't matter. And like he had talked about the STL format, you can put that out to the machine in the assembly form, and then there's some processes to get it the parts, because you know, you're doing gears and everything else, so there's going to be some powder that'll break down in it. You still have to clean up the parts a little bit, but once that's all done, yeah, you've got a functional prototype part that'll actually work for you. That box there, same thing, all at the same time. So that's the polyjet materials there, using different machine types. So my background is I've been around this stuff since 1995, 96. I joined actually the Technology House, which was my first place. It's funny, the three slides he has here, I worked at the Technology House. That's where I first was introduced to the SLA technology. Boundary Systems was a reseller for Stratasys. I don't think they're currently no longer in that business. But that's where I had been exposed to that polyjet process there. And then the technologies that I'm around now with metal parts that you've been seeing here, that's kind of where my growth pattern's gone, is seeing those new technologies and taking advantage of those. So learning to build parts that you couldn't manufacture, thinking outside of the box, coming up with new ideas, and being more innovative with your processes or your projects. A company like GE, they took a part. It was 26 parts inside of that GE motor part that they have that they were developing in Cincinnati. Now, through the additive manufacturing process, it's one part. So, and they're producing thousands of them. There's literally a lab, it's called Morris Technologies was the company. They had just a massive room full of these machines producing these parts for them now. So instead of having these large manufacturing facilities creating 26 different parts, now they're in one lab area and they're printing these parts out, thousands and thousands of them at a time in one process when they're all said and done with them now.
To add this question, so this was built, business support. Okay? Once you remove the blue structure, most everybody was removed. Same thing for this one. Okay? Once you build, there's some support structure, then it's right? But once you remove the blue part, then it's the same thing here and all other pieces. That's why they can reduce the piece of
There's another part that was going around. I had a coin in the center of that. We worked with a company that's called 3D Systems. The technology that they had there is their Pro X series. Yeah, so this part here, don't look at the name on it anymore. That lab is no longer available or anything there. So if you wrote that down, see me. I'll give you a business card of where we're at now. But what we did here was they told us, you can't do this. This is not possible with what you want to do here. We didn't believe them. So what we did was we took this and we designed this part here. During the process, we were able to reach into the chamber. We had a whole set of coins. I'm sure the U.S. Mint's going to probably be a little angry with us for using those parts, but we took those and we stopped the process. We took the material away that was inside of that, and we replaced it with the coin. Went back, we turned the machine back on, and we finished the process. Now we have an encapsulated coin inside of that. So this started to get us, our brains thinking a little bit, putting bearings inside of things. You know, things that you would typically need to have secondary functions that you would want to do around those. We took those and we started developing those processes around that. So I hooked up, Parabolic Designs is a design and manufacturing company, and I've teamed up with a lot of these different processes, and I know all these processes. I kind of think outside of the box. I don't think one process is the way to go. I think you have to have an intermix of these processes in order to get to where you're at. One other example I'll share with you real quick. This is this part here, we developed this for a customer who was developing, it's an injection mold tool part for an electronics mold. Now, typically it takes 256 of these parts to build the molds that they have for them. So I went to an old mold shop, I'm an injection mold tool kid, that's where I started my business and where I was from. I asked my old boss, I handed him this part and I said, how many of these can you produce for me and how long would it take you? I said, I need 250 of these finished parts, how long will it take you? He said, Aaron, you're talking 6 weeks, 8, 10 weeks at the most, you know, to get those parts done. I could print out all 250 parts in about a 12-hour period. Now, the secondary operation is going back and using an EDM process or something that, so here where Dr. Troy was talking about intermixing those technologies, this doesn't replace his technology, but it gets his parts faster for him. So now, instead of waiting 6, 10, 12 weeks for those parts, At the end of the week, he's got all the parts ready to go, all finished and ready to go into production with those. Now, these parts right here, we did some Rockwell testing on them. This was soft tooling, so the materials are coming along, right? So we're talking about a 42 Rockwell, and if that doesn't mean much to anybody else, this is strong enough that we can take it to tooling and we can do some production molding with these parts right here in our hands. So, and again, that time to market, everybody's got to get to market faster these days. We need to get there as fast as possible. So the technology is coming, so many different facets, so many different things. The carbon fiber printers, you know, it's another company I had teamed up with, this Mark One. Now they're printing several different materials in there. You've got your standard processes that they're using there, but now we're putting Kevlar into them. We're putting carbon fiber into them. That's something that, you know, last year, like 2 years ago, this stuff was unheard of. It was only this guy right here developing those types of technologies and working with that stuff. Now these technologies are coming to market, and they're coming to market at a very cheap rate. The common theme that we hear is, you gotta be kidding me, it's that cheap? You say that, somebody on the other end is gonna say, oh, we need to get our prices up. So this is a good time to get into those markets now, so.
When I see that slide right where they show the Boeing airplanes, there are 20,000 parts made.
22,000.
Yeah. Even the pasty or so the better part. Yeah, I knew that, but not the number, but I knew that. No, not. Yeah, it depends, you know, if needed a highly precise in the surfaces, maybe surfaces, then we have them.
This one actually has the ProLabs. They changed within the process so that you can refine that as you're going through it, and you're getting a much finer finish. So this is all one process. It's not touched at the end. Again, you're getting different micron finishes on each of these parts as you build them. So they identified it all in one in the software to say, hey, in this area here, I need a 5, 10, 15, 20 micron finish on it. And that's all done at the same time. It's getting better and better as the days go on and as the years come together. But right now, this is what they can do. So, correct. Yeah. A lot of that's going to go away, and you'll have to turn the time. Good.
Yeah.
We have design, yes, what do you think? So you?
Yeah, I just met with a customer yesterday who's developing a drone for agriculture, and he's spending tens of thousands of dollars in having tooling produced over in China. They had this part built. We showed him the machine yesterday, took out of him and showed him, and he said, I'm going to buy 5 of these machines because he replaced all that technology and stopped producing the molds over there and waiting. Technology, he just prints the parts out and now he can build those right there. And the cool thing about it is you can rethink how you're designing it, right? We've got this whole concept of how we build parts these days, and then as engineers or designers, we're all in this mindset of how we build parts. Oh, you can't do it that way, either we've got that, that's going to be a prohibitor for us. No, think outside of that now. You want to design something that's got an injection mold tool, say. A cooling channel that maybe a helical cut inside of that. How would you build that? How would you manufacture that? We just designed it. If we designed it in the software now, perfect. So that's the way that we like to think now. So rethinking those and replacing them, no longer waiting for the parts of China or whatever.
Consumer product.
Is that? Consumer product.
Absolutely.
So that's what he's doing.
Yeah, and question.
Sure. Like they're nylon, like, you know, they're close to materials that you would touch on a daily basis in your life.
the metals are, these are actual metals, but at a nanoparticle level. So we're putting those in a bed, and we're using a laser to cure those apart. And that bed chamber that we're using, and the machine that we use is a nitrogen bed. So there's a nitrogen and oxygen that help that laser or sensor that material onto it. So they're all safe materials at that point. Now, I say safe in that you're touching everything up and you're drying out. Obviously, you have to be very cautious when you're working with those materials.
Heavy pieces in the So we've been, when it comes to the issue of fear, more and more options become.
As far as medical is going right now, as far as medical is going now, now instead of having, there was a company, Zimmer, up in Indiana that I had worked with, and what they were doing was they had small, medium, and large for their sizes, right? That was the range that they had. Now they're going in and really scanning the area or the hip parts that they're going to replace, and they're custom building those parts to their company. Manufacturers, those are proprietary through the company that you work with. So 3D Systems has their own proprietary materials. Now there are other companies now, depending on who you go with and which machines, they have open bed technologies that allow other companies to develop the materials that they want, and they can bring them into their system. Now a company like 3D Systems might say, oh, you avoid your warranty if you use the other materials. And those are the things that you get in, you know, you start messing around with, and you have to take chances where you want to take them. That's going to open up a huge market over the next couple years. Like you said, a lot of these patents have gone away now, and you're starting to see it just explode with the different machines that are out there available now. And it's going to have the same thing with material. The same thing will happen with other materials.
Can you do 3D printing through a bending type machine and with a different material food product? Yeah, there is, I did that here, but food, yeah. Yes, 2 years ago, I submitted a proposal for food.
Okay.
Just think about just, you know, some starch, you know, peanut butter powder, and why do you use this?
Yeah, I've actually seen the one that did fudge. Okay. So they had the machine and it was different types of fudges with different colors and stuff inside.
It's pretty simple. They're going to use the screen to push, right? Right. You can control that. You can have your own feel. You can have your own, you know,
body. Your own body. Whatever. Right there.
Yes.
Like injection molding, where you can design a channel or waterway in the part insert in Portland.
Yep.
You can do that with this technology.
Yeah, I mean, it's rethinking that whole mold and having a better understanding of that. There's even new software that are coming out now that Insight, I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, that's another, or Inspire, I think is what it's called. But software, you get your CAD software that develop the standard stuff. Now it takes this and says, hey, what are the strengths that you need, or what do we have to make sure of, so that water channel or that four pin, let's focus around that and get rid of all the other material, and then we can print that part, whether you want that or how you want it to look. That's what we can do.
So the material of my fibers, given that orientation, is
the same kind of strength? Yeah, that's the point. The way that they can, let's say, some just basic packing of food, packing of the, as long as they can join, you know, to have an exclusive and fine. So basically, when you bring, you know, the product this way, I mean, you throw out the just this way, forward and this way. But there's a variation, but not 5% is not enough. So, also, if you think we just discussed most, then there's one question. So, you know, we go out to the market properties that have a few months to the village. There's all different, you know, features which they have different courses.
We actually were at the University over in Indiana that was doing studies with UL testing, and that specifically was, you know, care.
I've heard that they would like to make organs for transplants in the future. Do you have any idea where they are in that process or anything on that?
I also work on the campaign for my PhD in Korea. I use 24-gene fumarate that is high compatible by the grade group for bone regeneration. Which is that there are a lot of things that's like FDA approved, but immature series now too. That's not my nuclear, but vice university has a nuclear, but it's not approved yet. But those organ things, more complicated. Bone, I don't know how many spheres there may be. Several times there. But the parts and others, because it's so many things there. Several versions of the organ. Even though we can make an empty, right? The body is a part, empty. How can you grow spheres for specific, things? It's very hard. But they're working on it. A lot of the biomedical engineers working on things. But here, for the vendor,
What would be the simplest? Is the skin the simplest way to do?
In the end of the year, the agriculture has to be in the front form of some different tissues. It's not easy. One possible thing is, I think it already worked, the catalyst.
Back to that Jane Fonda movie with the guy Jaws and the medical team.
Yeah.
Get permits up.